Hello, I'm Dr. Cicelina Ledbetter, Associate Vice President of Student Development at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host for A Healthy Mind. The purpose of this television series is to educate and inform our community about mental health, from public policy and environmental factors to the various disorders that affect healthy minds. According to the website of the National Institute of Mental Health, bipolar disorder, also known as manic depressive illness, is a brain disorder that causes unusual shifts in mood, energy, activity levels, and the ability to carry out day-to-day tasks. There are four basic types of bipolar disorder, and all of them involve clear changes in mood, energy, and activity levels. These moods range from periods of extremely up or elated and energized behavior known as manic episodes to very sad, down, or hopeless periods known as depressive episodes. Less severe manic periods are known as hypomanic episodes. Proper diagnosis and treatment help people with bipolar disorder lead healthy and productive lives. Melinda Hasbrook is the founder and former executive director of Our Door Community Wellness Center, a peer-led resource activity center. Melinda earned a Master's of Public Health degree from the George Washington University Milken Institute School of Public Health and a law degree from William and Mary School of Law. Melinda self-identifies as a current consumer of mental health services who has recovered from serious mental illnesses, including bipolar disorder, suicidality, and bulimia. Melinda developed a passion for mental and behavioral health advocacy from her own experiences recovering from her serious mental illness, utilizing the District of Columbia Mental and Behavioral Health Systems of Care and her law school's counseling center. Welcome, Melinda.
Hi.
That's a whole mouthful.
Yes.
Yay for counseling centers. So, you know, you have, you are a breath of fresh air because you're willing to disclose and share about your struggles with mental illness like bipolar and suicidality and bulimia. So there's a lot of stigma.
Lots of
stigma. How did you just like bust out and put on the pink suit and say, how do you do that when stigma is such a big part of that community?
Well, my narrative ends with stigma busting, that if I didn't speak about it, then others can benefit from my story and I couldn't keep living in recovery. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely started with a lot of stigma that I had to get through. You inherit stigma through your communities, your family, the culture of America, the culture of the world. You inherit these stigmas that tell you, shh, don't say anything.
Yeah.
This is not good. You're not praying hard enough. Your faith isn't there. You're just not working hard enough.
Girl, you gotta pray it out.
So it's just, many of these. And at home, a lot of times families just don't understand because people have been too afraid to talk about it.
What about your home?
In my home,
as you were growing up, when did you know that there was something going on with you?
For me, I found out something was going on with me in law school. I definitely had exhibited things, but it was never a mechanism that hurt. It was always helped me. So if someone had looked at my abilities and my energy levels, they probably would have said, if they were a psychologist or a psychiatrist. But for me, it was I naturally have a higher mood.
Yeah.
It's been protective of some early childhood traumas that allowed me not to even think about them as I grew. Mm-hmm. But for me, going to school full time, working five jobs, and being active in my community, not sleeping, that was just me. And because I was able to do that without the dysfunction, then it never became a problem until it was dysfunctional.
Okay, so you are high functioning.
High functioning all the way there.
Which sometimes contributes to people not believing or not quite understanding, because you didn't just show up flat on your back. You were five jobs, law school.
I was a leader in the community since I was a little kid. I was doing everything to go on a successful track. And I grew up in Capitol Heights, Maryland.
Okay.
My parents are from D.C.
Okay.
and been a D.C. resident for 20 years.
Wow.
But for me, when I was in law school, at home, my brother was injured in a shooting. And that, for me, was traumatic in that it knocked a lot of things that my brain as a child had kept away from me, yes, regarding some really adverse childhood experiences.
Okay.
And so that, with returning back to school and my heart and mind being back home, just was a bit too much. And then for me, the bipolar disorder became dysfunctional. And through the last decade or so, I've investigated my family's history and found out how much mood disorders are genetically part of my family,
right,
and just how much trauma my family has undergone, and that then you tend to send that down the genetic,
right,
stream.
Right.
So it's not a big surprise when I've done the investigation that I have a mood disorder. I just became the first person to be very vocal about it, because I realized that it was the hardest thing I ever had to do, was first not to kill myself,
right,
because it was like, you're telling me the thing that has always been there for me, my brain, now is sick.
Wow.
And for me, that was so shameful. I was given a message of shame, mm-hmm, that you should not talk about this. This will prevent your future. This will prevent everything. You won't be able to succeed. And luckily, I was introduced to a wonderful counselor at College of William & Mary that was able to hold my hope until I could take it back,
yeah,
and then continue on in getting a lot of help up in the DC system with another wonderful set of therapists.
Because a lot of those messages of shame that you're talking about, which is really insidious, which really can cause more damage. You know, a lot of that comes from people who really are well-meaning.
They're really well-meaning. it's where people, I mean, I've been to a Christian therapist,
yes,
and it'll start with, well, where's your faith? Where's your prayer? I mean, I've had people say to me when I was very frail because of how severe my eating disorder had gotten,
yeah. Yeah.
Who were saying, can't you just eat a salad? I mean,
when they say that, what does that feel like?
It confirms that you don't understand me at all, and it confirms in my what I was already thinking, that I don't have a place in this world,
okay,
that no one will ever understand me.
And that's what you intellectualize, but how, mm-hmm, does it feel when someone says,
it was utterly despair.
Okay.
It was hopelessness. You felt worthless, and you really do decide that you go down, just keep going down farther,
wow,
and further,
yeah,
and hospitalization after hospitalization doesn't make a difference.
Right.
And you become resolute that it's
I'm
time
broken.
To end it.
Yeah. I'm broken.
There's not gonna be a bright future in this.
Right, right.
For me, it was getting out of, getting past a community that is a rough community, and being offered a corporate attorney position, a six-figure salary, and having to turn that down, mm-hmm, to focus on recovery.
Right.
And right. That wasn't a good feeling.
No.
That wasn't a good feeling at
no.
all.
And your experience is not unlike many people who deal with bipolar and bulimia and
yes.
other and suicidality. So fast forward a little bit, or maybe it's just take a step, because it's, you've done so much,
yes.
to our door. What is our door?
Well, I got to the point where I was learning to be open about my recovery through trainings, through the fact that I knew a lot of people were suffering, and just
yeah.
that jaw-dropping experience that people have when you share, they're mm-hmm. at first they're just like, did you just share that? But
mm-hmm,
then
mm-hmm.
it's, oh my gosh, I've been going through this, or my close family member or a friend. And it just really became how important my openness was about it. That became my superpower,
mm-hmm,
as far as stigma related. And then after I was getting stronger in my recovery, I still didn't know what I wanted to do.
Okay.
I knew I could do anything. I know I could do anything.
Yes.
I had the ability to do anything.
No
my
doubt.
Parents raised me that
I
way.
Have no doubt.
But I had no passion to do anything.
Okay.
But one day somebody asked me, what do you do? And I said, I'm an advocate. I didn't know what that meant.
Wow.
But then I understood that everything that happened for me over the last few years, I've been able to accept that as my purpose.
Mm.
And I'm actually grateful for everything that's ever happened for me, including
wow.
forced hospitalizations,
wow.
including sexual assaults,
yeah.
everything. So we get to the point of our door, Community Wellness Center, that was created under a partnership with Green Door Behavioral Health mm-hmm. and the DC Department of Behavioral Health through a contract that I wrote in response to an RFP, a request for proposal. And we were funded to start a community-based, peer-run, self-identifying peers in the community to put on services for resources and wellness activities and be out there spreading the message of hope and access and what our communities need.
And so right now you are former executive director of Green Door,
of our door.
Mm-hmm. So right now the community that you serve is who?
The community that I serve is the under-access, underprivileged. It tends in this area to be the Ward 7 and 8 community.
Okay. But that present with mental illness?
That present with lots of chronic conditions, including homelessness, mental illness, trauma. They social determinants of health are devastating in these areas. And so it tends to be a population that's not easily categorized in one bucket.
Okay.
But in this, the recent assessment of health, DC residents identified mental health as their number one concern for health. And so you can have insurance and you can have, that doesn't equal access, that doesn't equal quality.
Right.
And so just working in my local community and nationally, I serve on national committees and I speak nationally about it. It's that work that you do for that underserved, underrepresented population, it's able to influence policies that affect all of the nation.
So DC residents said that mental health was number one among
all of their health conditions. Where you expect it to be HIV, you expect it to be...
Which is epidemic.
Right, breast cancer, it's mental health.
So why do you think that is? Because we know that bipolar gets a bad rap. Mm-hmm. Every time something goes on, if there's a shooting, there's a plane crash.
Right.
We're always thrown around very loosely, I think, to some extent.
Very loosely.
Bipolar.
Yes.
What do you think that's about? Why do we constantly give bipolar a bad rap?
So we constantly do that because we have to be able to accept something.
Right.
We have to name it. And then we have to name it something evil.
Right.
Something that we don't understand.
Or we perceive as evil because bipolar is not evil.
And it's not. It's it's just like diabetes. It's a health condition.
Right.
It's a health condition that needs to be diagnosed and maintenance. Mm-hmm. It can be maintenance in multiple ways. Most of the time it does need to be stabilized first before you start taking other methods to continue your recovery. So I stay in recovery from the things I do to take care of myself, which involve a whole health process.
So when you get people that come through the door, what symptoms do they present with? Because I imagine many of them have gone undiagnosed, so they don't really know. What symptoms usually present that says, okay, hold on, we think that this person is suffering with this mental illness and they have not been treated? What do they do? How do they show up?
Without putting a clinical diagnosis on it, a lot of times that presents as someone who, depending on where they're at in their stages, but they could be someone who is very detached in their thinking and their orientation, that is speaking rapidly. I've been there where you're not, it's not the same as schizophrenia, so you're not having hallucinations and delusions, but everything when you're more on the manic or hypomanic side, it's go, 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 and you can do this, and you need to do this, and you have to do this, and you're doing all of this, and you don't have a need for sleep. You don't really have a need to eat. You start doing more risky behaviors like hypersexuality, stealing, things like that. You're irritable.
Yeah.
You might experience God at another higher level. You might think that you have superpowers.
Yeah.
And then with that can all come crashing down into a very deep, severe depression, which then goes where you'll be isolated, where you can get suicidal and you can act on those feelings. So it can, and then depending on how your bipolar is managed and what type you have.
So it's tricky then. It can be really tricky.
I learned something new. Every time I think, oh, I have this under control.
Don't think that anymore.
It's with me forever.
Yeah.
And so I don't call it a gift and a curse. I call it just a part of who I am.
Yes.
And just like with anything, I've learned how to do things better, and I keep learning on how to manage it.
Yeah. So I think that DC residents call it a mental health crisis because, you know, what you said about them wanting to be compulsory, they have to name it. But I also think the media sort of feeds into it a little bit. We are often trying to use that label to describe anything that we don't understand. And so mental health, I think, in general, we just don't understand it. Has that been?
I do believe that. It's safe for people to say, oh, they had to be crazy. They had to be this. It's not easy to go down the investigative route to say, well, maybe this person had access to 100 guns and, you know, and it has nothing to do with them having a mental health disorder. So a lot of times it's also glamorous. So if you're saying this person, they had to be crazy, they had to be this, and just even using that kind of terminology, you have people who maybe like me, who aren't public, who might not be public about it, sitting there like, whoa, I better never share this with a friend or family member. I never put this on a disability form because this stigma. Messaging,
stigma.
And it doesn't seem to matter. It doesn't seem to matter how much you fight those words, that stigma always stays there. So the only thing you can do is start to address it. But it is also labeled differently for different populations. So a lot of you do see now more programming around people who are in recovery from bipolar disorder, but it's not, it's very fictional. Yeah. Like, I love Homeland, but there's no way a CIA officer would be able to be open about bipolar disorder and be have security clearance.
Yeah, I mean, and that's another that's another thing that follows is when you go to the doctor, is wanting to suffer in silence because you know that if they put that you have a mental illness, that's going to be a part of your file.
It is. I get discounted. I don't like going to the emergency room. Yeah. I mean, it's almost like you have to drag me in and you have to convince me that it can't wait until tomorrow to see a doctor, a scheduled appointment. And so a lot of times I've had where I've consulted with the on-call doctor who says you really need to go in. Because I've received so much stigma around when they ask you what medical conditions you have, and when I say bipolar disorder, because it is important, then it becomes a totally different,
a whole different conversation.
A whole different conversation. It doesn't matter that I'm well spoken. It doesn't matter that I'm educated. That I work. It doesn't
matter. Immediately, the mental illness sucks all the air out of the room.
Immediately, and then it's almost they present with. Oh, I'm surprised. You were absolutely right about this going on.
You can't be smart and bipolar.
Right. So,
when community members, when they come to our door, what should, first I want to ask, is it open and is it free?
It's open and it's free. And the model that that I was running, it was open and it was free to anyone 18 and older.
Okay.
If you were under 18, you need to be escorted.
Okay.
Because we don't do background checks, just for safety reasons.
Okay.
But it was open to it was open to anyone. It was limited barriers, no referrals required.
So if a parent suspects that their child is going through a breakdown, is our door the place that they would come for resources?
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay. It's one of the places because sometimes it's not the person who needs help that looks for help first. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's a person who's caring for that person or personally connected. And that's often because someone who's who's sick might not be able to say, hey, I'm really, really sick.
And when you think about, you know, I'm glad you said that, when you think about the people that support people with mental illness as severe as bipolar can be, what message do we have for them? Like, what do we tell these parents and these caregivers who are, you might be husband, might be wife, might be mother, grandmother? How do you tell, what do you tell to them when they come?
I've had that experience in a lot of settings, and I tell people, including my family,
that
first get a little educated about it, even if it's just reviewing National Institute of Mental Health's website or the Mayo's website, just so you can understand what some of these words mean.
Yeah.
And ask how you can help.
Ask who?
Ask the person who's sick, how can I help? If they're able to communicate that, then respect that. Some people aren't able to communicate that, so you might need a higher level of advocacy. Mm-hmm. But unless you've been really trained in this, don't assume you're the expert.
Yeah, it could be muddy waters to navigate this whole process. And so coming to Outdoor, though, could be part of that, could be the beginning.
Yes, and then you need support. I mean, if you're going in this almost at the level of a clinical support, you need support because you're not going to be able to, the frustrations that you're experiencing and sometimes the things that are being said or done to you, you're not going to be able to have a conversation with that person right now about that. Mm-hmm. And then you can start to also be affected by a lot of that that's going on. So making sure you're stable is just as important.
Okay.
But the person who needs help needs to own it. They have to own it.
Right. Which is hard sometimes.
It's very hard.
Especially at the beginning when they're trying to figure it out, when that first break happens or the first major break happens, because often I think it's a series of little breaks.
Definitely.
And then you go, wait a minute, all of a sudden I'm flat on my back.
Absolutely.
So something happens. But I think that it's difficult to really come to terms with it as the person.
It really is. When my first when my first therapist told me what was going on, I was like, oh, give me a month of this and I'll be great.
Right.
You know, it's you know, he's like, no, it's a long-term process.
Exactly.
I said, at the most 6 months.
Right. Right.
You know,
right.
It's like, right. And that was in 2002.
Right. Right. Well, I mean, speaking of medication and going on and going off and being compliant and being non-compliant.
It's part of the process.
Yeah. So how do you, dealing with compliance and dealing with medication, I know that there have been all kinds of clinical trials over the years with how to deal with and address bipolar. Are there some new treatments that are non-pharmaceutical that could help? I mean, I don't know whether that's sort of in your purview, but so many people are prescribed drugs. Are there other things that you can do to really get a handle on the illness?
Well, bipolar disorder is biological, so sometimes there is a need for a medical intervention that's going to involve medicine, and whether or not it's going to be forever becomes a question, but also there should be titration involved.
Right. So tell people what titration is.
Titration is really dosing the medicine for the person and their needs, given their situation, their environment, and their biology.
Right.
So what you may start with may not be the same thing down the road.
Right.
And as you learn to cope with the symptoms and you learn to maybe prevent environmental triggers, then you probably will be able to decrease or even go off medicine.
Right.
But there's a lot of things that I do to keep my medicine dosages low.
Yeah.
But I had to accept that if I kept them low, that my because I have rapid cycling bipolar disorder, that it would fluctuate more. But I didn't want to be dulled out. So I wanted to feel life. And so with that, I have ups and downs more frequently. Mm-hmm. But doing things like keeping myself from being isolated, staying in therapy. Therapy, I think, is very important.
Yes, consistently.
Consistently. I go through sometimes 2 times a week to 1 time a week. Staying regular with the medical side of things.
Yes.
Some people have other imbalances that do contribute to some of their triggers. So some people have thyroid conditions that need to be checked.
Okay.
Some of their nutrients. And other people use different things like swimming and yoga and things like that. But it really, you can customize it to the person.
So you talked about a little bit about what peer support can do, what families can do to help. I want to make sure that we touch on the community policing part because I think it's so important. And I also think that that's probably one of the reasons why in DC, you know, they've rated mental health as number one, is because they're always concerned, given what the media does, with the community police and moving more towards that model. Not saying that that's what we do now.
Yes.
But being able to train, what are your thoughts about police officers understanding how to deal with mental health? Because, you know, when they find people acting erratically,
it's tough.
But there are ways that we can train officers to deal with. And you talked earlier about a CIO officer off camera. I want to make sure we get that piece in.
So CIO is a crisis intervention officer. And they go beyond the standard police training. And I do believe it's a volunteer program. But they're exposed to people in the community who have interacted with the police and have a diagnosis and self-identify with mental health disorders. They hear the good, the bad, and the ugly. They go through more sensitivity training, and then they're able to report to scenes that involve a mental health crisis. Sometimes people have to ask for a CIO or ask the sergeant to send one, because they don't report to all scenes, and not all calls include enough information. Okay. But you have a right to request that. And what happens is you have someone who understands that there's a different approach to talking to someone who's in crisis.
Yeah.
That it's not just let's jump, you know, right. That things that are done in that setting can traumatize a person further.
That's a good point, because whether you're a community member making the call or whether you're a family member, you can always say, I want to request a CIO officer to be on the scene, because there's something that may not look.
Absolutely. Right. I've done it, and I've also witnessed people in psychiatric distress and called the police, and I've also offered to assist, providing my business card to show that I do have some experience.
Wow.
But even in that situation, I don't feel comfortable saying I'm a peer. Because a lot of times you can get dismissed right away,
right.
And it's and people, they'll see the card, they see executive director, they see this, and I'm able to talk
Surely.
To a person.
You
right.
can.
And I'm, you know, and I'm able to talk to them, and a lot of times they do go, but they go willingly, you know.
Right.
So instead of having to be handcuffed and forced down, they're able to get into the ambulance instead.
Right. And also the approach.
The approach
when
is
they know
very,
that somebody is compassionate on the scene, I think that resonates.
It really does. It really does.
And
for me, there are times one day I went through different parts of DC, and in that one day I had five interactions with people I knew. Some were homeless, some were executives, some were case managers, some were neighbors, just throughout DC. And one of my friends who was with me that whole day was like, all these people, they know you from the community. And she's like, your engagement is the same. And I was like, because we're all just people.
Yeah.
And we all deserve that level of engagement. And people remember a friendly face.
They do. And you certainly have a friendly face.
Yes.
So thank you for all of the work that you do. You've really been in the street and getting it done.
Thank you.
And this is a great place to sort of end. I'd like to thank Ms. Hasbrook, who is actually called Dr. Hasbrook. If you'd like to learn more about bipolar or the topics that we discuss, I invite you to visit the website of the National Institute of Mental Health at www.nimh.nih.gov. To learn more about Our Door and Melinda, visit her at her website, www.mrhasb.com. I'm Dr. Cicelina Grosser Ledbetter, and if you'd like to reach me, you can visit me on Facebook and Twitter at Dr. Cis. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time on A Healthy Mind.